saga over the non-declaration of assets against the chief justice of Nigeria, and the allegations on Justice Walter Onagan continues to escalate as the Federal High Court seated in Abuja has extended a restraining order against the continuation of the trial of the chief justice of Nigeria to January the 28th. And name and logo of the All Progressives Congress APC is not captured in the lease released by INEC for the River State governorship election. It's a case of a River State APC hot water. And thanks for joining everyone. This is Politics Today, live on Channels Television. I'm Shoakim Aloye in Abuja, the nation's capital. Let's check out the countdown clock right here on Channels Television as we look forward to the 2019 general election. It is 29 days to the crucial elections, less than a month. So the day is moving inching closer and closer. So at last, some dust has settled as the unparty Independent National Electoral Commission, INEC, today released the full names of candidates for the presidential and National Assembly elections. The electoral umpire published the names on its website on Thursday, but 29 days to the general elections. This will bring to rest perhaps speculations and confusion over names of candidates of some political parties where there have been disagreements in the post-primaries era. So let's tell you that one of such cases is in Rivers State, where the INEC in Rivers State has released the names of candidates for the National Assembly elections. The names of the candidates were reviewed on Thursday in a list signed by INEC Secretary Rose Olanira Anthony. However, the names and candidates of the All Progressives Congress APC were excluded from the list. Candidates of the People's Democratic Party, PDP, Social Democratic Party, SDP, and Labour Party, amongst others, made the list. The resident electoral commissioner in Rivers State, Obo Efanga, insisted that the electoral umpire would always obey court judgments. And politicians have continued to move around the country. Today, the APC presidential campaign train touched base in Benin City and Asaba, the capital cities of Edo and Delta States. The party is confident on the work they say they have done and are optimistic of their chances at the polls.
I assure you, under this leadership, our interest is to serve Nigeria, to get Nigerians to live together and work for our nation. I assure you, the fundamental objectives we have identified and campaigned on in 2015 are still relevant. The country has to be secured to be properly managed. And properly management means doing well in the economy. We have turned to agriculture and industries, and we are able virtually to achieve food security as a nation. A lot of young people have been mobilized, they have gone back to land, and they haven't regretted it. The third point is corruption. I assure you, all those that have fraudulently enriched themselves when they are trusted with public funds will eventually get them and deal with them. We are doing it. We will continue to do it. And I assure you, we will not abuse trust. I assure you, the programs mentioned here about development of Niger Delta will be taken even more seriously.
Well, let's go to our main story of the day. A federal high court sitting in Abuja today has extended a restraining order against the continuation of the trial of the Chief Justice of Nigeria, Justice Walter Onagan. to January 28. The court presided over by Justice Edward Maha gave the order on Thursday after a counsel representing the respondents informed the court that his client had not been served. Justice Maha therefore ordered a fresh service of the court summons to the respondents and directed that the date of service be included in the proof of service before the next hearing. Before adjourning the matter, he ruled that the order for parties to maintain the status quo remained in force. The order included, amongst other things, that the trial of Justice Onogun scheduled to continue on January at the Court of Conduct Tribunal, CCT, may have to be suspended pending further directives from the court. Meanwhile, the Code of Conduct Bureau, CCB, said it has formally served court summons on the CJN as directed by the tribunal. The CJN is standing trial at the tribunal over allegations of non-declaration of assets leveled against him by the CCB. So let's get the conversation started, everyone, shall we? I have joining me Mr. Ahmed Tanimu, a lawyer, and here also a senator, a federal lawmaker, Senator Shehu Sani. Thank you so much, gentlemen, for coming on today.
Thank you for having me.
With what we've seen today, Senator, and what has been happening, a lot of linkage has been put into the perspectives of what has happened to the CGN and the allegations leveled against him. Considering the timing, the procedure, and the 2019 elections, what are your immediate reactions with this ongoing story?
Well, thank you, Sharon, for having me. First and foremost is that we cannot escape the analysis and the perception that the trial of the CJ is simply a case of political persecution.
Really?
Yes, the ruling political elite have an agenda, and that is to see how, with this trial, the judiciary can be intimidated and such a man can be silenced. And it is not unusual for things like this to happen. If you look at the trends in democracies, especially in third world states, you find that there is always that fear and apprehension whenever you have a chief justice of a federation that is not in tandem with the thinking, the political inclination of those in office. There is always that fear. Even in developed democracies like the United States, you still see each time judges are going to be replaced, you will see the replacement of just judges is always in line with the political thinking of whoever is the executive. During Obama, when he is bringing his Supreme Court judges, he brings them from the left, and the same thing happening to Trump at this time here. So I, for one, will say clearly that we need to be very careful because this trial of Onogun has generated a lot of emotions and has also created bad blood, especially within the regions, the North and the South, particularly the South-South. The positions of the South-South governors and also the leaders from that region makes it a very serious matter that we should take it as a matter of that is could be faithful to our country, yes.
Quickly, before I come to Mr. Tanimu here, when the vice president said yesterday that the president was not aware about the initiation of that of the allegations or the trial against the CJN, and it does come out that there are moves also and directives that the NFIU should freeze the account of the CJN, and with all of this, does it correlate with the perception or the analysis of the fact that the president is not aware?
Well, if you can go back to the trends of events in the last 3 years, not being aware doesn't seem to be lack of knowledge. But each time you hear the president is not aware, and I think he is simply trying to answer the question by being neutral or evasive about it. And to me, it is very much impossible for such a high-profile personality in the country, in the person of the Chief Justice of the Federation.
So you think the president is aware?
It is impossible for him not to be aware.
Now, the president that you know, you've met him one-on-one. When you had your issues with the APC, you've met him one-on-one. Does it look like, and I'll quickly take you back to almost 4 years now, when the election in the National Assembly happened, the president simply said, I don't want to get involved. So does it look like that kind of person that would be aware and allow this?
Well, you see, he has a philosophy which he called it being for everybody and for nobody. But interpreting his own political positions many times means that being not aware simply is being evasive of taking responsibility, and he should know that the buck stops on his table. It is not possible for a Chief Justice of the Federation to be so summoned for such a trial without the president knowing what is happening. I don't believe that, but I believe he is trying to use a diplomacy and say he doesn't want to get involved.
Well, you're one of those that have said there is government in this government before.
Well, I may not say, but for me, I will not believe that the president don't know what is happening.
Let me come to Mr. Tanimo. I mean, you know the legal implication of this. Some of your colleagues in the law profession have said that this is a disaster waiting to happen in Nigeria's democracy and in the legal practice. Do you hold that view, considering the ruling of the Federal High Court today is still sustaining the restraining order on the continuation of the action by the CCT?
Thank you very much. I completely disagree with that view. I don't hold that view. The law is very clear. If you look at the provision of the law establishing both the CCD and the Code of Conduct Tribunal, it's very clear. I want to make reference to the issue of the president being aware before going back to the main issue here. It's not provided anywhere in the law that the president should be aware. In fact, it will amount to interfering with the dispensation of justice. Ordinarily, we have system, we have gamut of laws that are in place, and they should be allowed to work.
But
it matters not.
Speaking,
it matters
Tanimo,
not.
Politically speaking, is it possible for the president not to be aware?
The issue is not important. He's being aware or not is not important. If you look at the law does not require the president to give assent, to give permission before anybody, regardless of his status, of his position, to be tried before. This is the underlying factor should be, has an offense been alleged and has it been committed? That is where our focus should be.
You have an idea of the person of President Buhari?
I do.
If you think he was aware or he was brought to his notice, what do you think would have been his immediate reaction?
I will look at it. Maybe he will look at it from a political angle and he will try to intervene. But we should go beyond what the president would do or would not do. We should look at, are we allowing our system to thrive? If there is a law that has been provided and the law is very, very clear, it's very, very specific, that if somebody commits an offense, is alleged to have committed an offense, the law should be allowed to take its full course. A lot of people made reference to the case of Ngwajiwa versus the Federal Republic of Nigeria, and they give it a wrong interpretation. It doesn't in any way preclude the other organs of government from performing its functions. What it only says that judicial officers should first be investigated. But now you now ask the question, there's a demarcation. When you talk about official misconduct, things that you do in the course of your official responsibilities, different from when you look at other issues like crime. For example, the judges are humans. They could commit crime. So will you say if a judge commits the offense of murder, offense of capital offense?
We'll continue this conversation after the break, but just in a breath, tell me this. Some of your colleagues describe this whole saga as a political suicide for our democracy.
I don't think so.
Really?
I don't think so.
Who would dig at more? I know Senator Shehu Sani would hold perhaps a different view from yours, but we'll talk about that and so much more. Senator Shehu Sani also, he has some controversial views about some of the issues that we'll bring up on the program today, plus my other guests on the program. We'll take a moment, and when we come back, we'll discuss more on this. Join us again, everyone.